Happy Sunday and good morning, Bethel family. Are you ready for worship? Before we get our Sunday worship celebration started, we have a few updates and reminders just for you. These are your Bethel happenings.
Rise, shine, and give God the glory. Join us every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 7 a.m. for Bethel's International Prayer Line. Use the dial-in details on your screen or visit our website for more information. Start your day in prayer.
Are you in need of a midweek worship experience? Tune in to the Hour of Power with IMAC every Wednesday at noon on Facebook and YouTube. Get your praise break on your lunch break.
Worship will begin shortly. We are so glad that you are joining us today. Make sure to follow us on social media. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.
And now it's time for our Bethel CYM update.
Hey, Bethel family. Join us this Friday for a family game night at 7 p.m. From all ages, 5 and up are welcome to come. Don't forget to wear your mask. We have all types of games, to board games, card games, and hard games, and even silly games too. I heard Pastor was an Uno champion. Let's see if he can keep up the title. Hope to see you guys there.
You've been listening to your Bethel happenings. Remember, you can always check out the latest news and updates on our website or our social media. Now, get ready for an explosive worship experience at Bethel AME Church. It's worship time. Let the praise begin.
But the story doesn't end there. Because on the third day, he got up with all power in his hand. Listen, I feel something moving. Is anybody glad he got up? What's his name? What's his name? What's his name? What's his name? There's power in his name. There's healing in his name. Demons tremble at the sound of a name. Y'all can destroy at the sound of a name.
What's his name? What's his name? What's his name? What's his name? He's been good. He's been kind. He's been wonderful all of the time. I love him. He's my friend.
God. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his surpassing greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with a lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with clanging cymbals. Praise him with the clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. Let everything. Don't let the rock cry out for you. Let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord.
Oh, come on, dance up, come on. With the food in your lips, come on, let's praise him. Hallelujah. How many know the power? There's power in the cross. Hallelujah. We're going to sing this hymn together. This the power of the cross. Hallelujah. All my worshipers, come on, just lift your hands. All over the sanctuary. For he is not dead, he is risen. Come on, let's sing all to see the dawn. All the perfect day. Christ on the road to Calvary. Tried by sinful men. Beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. Come on, say this the power. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us. name.
Oh, to see my name
written in the womb.
Written in the womb.
For through your suffering.
I am free.
Death is crushed to death.
Life is mine to live.
Won through your selfless love. Come on, say this, the power. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we love you. We honor you. You are awesome, and your grace is shown us sufficient. Heavenly Father, we know and we declare today that your mercy endures forever. And so, God, we're so excited that we are able to come to worship this morning to celebrate how you came down to earth, God. And even in the face of enemy, even though the devil tried to rear his ugly head on Sunday morning, early on a Sunday morning, you rose from the cross. You rose from the grave. You got up off of that cross. And for that, God, we say thank you. And so today, God, we declare resurrection in our lives. We declare today resurrection in our spirit. God, we declare today, oh God, that we know that we can speak to dead situations, God, and we know that we have resurrection power. And so, God, as we continue through this worship experience, oh God, we declare that any dead situations, any circumstances in our lives, that we are ready to get up. We declare that there are any dead places in our lives, Lord, that we're ready to go out, God. Today, God, we're ready to celebrate you, God, and how you got up off the cross. And so today, God, we celebrate the fact that you got the last word. We celebrate today, God, how the devil doesn't have the last word. We celebrate today that the doctors don't have the last word. God, we celebrate today that you have the last word in our finances, that you have the last word in our lives, that you have the last word, God. And so because we are so grateful that you do have the last word, Lord, we're going to avail ourselves and for the next few minutes to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise that you deserve. And so, God, we seal this prayer in the name that is above all names, that at that name every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you alone are Lord. In Jesus' name we seal this prayer. Together we say, amen, amen, and amen.
Jesus, Jesus, at the mention of your name, every knee will bow, tongue proclaim. Jesus, Jesus, you are Savior, you are Lord, and you are God. Can I get all of you just to sing that? Come on, say Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus.
At the mention of your name,
at the mention of your name,
every knee will bow. Jesus,
Jesus,
oh Jesus,
Jesus,
you are Savior, you are Savior, you are Lord.
are.
You're the only living God. Say. At the mention,
at the mention of your name,
every
knee will bow and tongue proclaim.
Say, Jesus,
Jesus,
I love to call him.
Jesus,
you are Savior,
you are Savior, you are Lord, and you are.
Come on, let's worship his splendor this morning. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Worthy to be adored.
Hallelujah.
Worthy to be magnified. Come on, the matchless name of Jesus. That name has all power. That name has healing. That name has deliverance. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. The keepers did shake and became as dead men.
And for fear of them, the keepers did shake and became as dead men.
Over here's where the story lightens up a little bit. An angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said, fear not.
Fear
the living amongst the dead. He is not here.
He is not here.
For he has risen as he said.
For he has risen as he said.
See where the place where the Lord used to lay.
See the place where the Lord lay.
Let's review the story one more time. An angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said, fear not. For I know.
For I know ye see Jesus who was crucified.
But he is not here.
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 Why are you looking for the living amongst the dead? He is not here.
He is not here.
For he has risen as he said.
For he has risen.
See the place where the Lord used to lay.
See the place where the Lord lay.
Then if you skip down, it says, remember how he said while he was yet in Galilee.
Remember how he said while he was yet in Galilee.
What did he say, soprano? Because he did just what he said.
Yes, Lord.
Because he's not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. And if he said it, you can believe it. Hallelujah. All my worshipers, come on, lift your hands. Hallelujah.
He has risen. Why are you? Thank you.
let's worship the Lord in this place. Come on, let's really worship the Lord in this house. If you're happy that he's still alive, come on, just stand up on your feet and give God praise on this Resurrection Sunday. Come on, let's just bless the name of the Lord. Come on, if you know it, help the choir sing. Chapter 20. Brother Drake continues to play. John chapter 20, verses 1 through 10. John chapter 20, verses 1 through 10. The sweet spirit in this place. John chapter 20, verses 1 through 10. When you have it, say amen. If you don't have it, say wait a minute. Still worshiping. We'll give you a moment.
Don't cry. Wipe your eyes. He's not dead. Oh, 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 don't you weep, for he's not asleep. Jehovah, he's not dead. Oh, don't cry. Why your eyes? He's not dead.
John chapter 20, John chapter 20, verses 1 through 10. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples return to their homes. From verses 6 and 7. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. Lord, we thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you, God, for the reality of an empty tomb. We thank you that we serve a living Savior who's in the world today. We thank you for the power of the resurrection. We thank you, God, that after years of COVID, we could gather together here at Bethel AME Church in Wilmington, Delaware. And are we yet alive and see each other's face? God, we give you praise for allowing us to worship in your sanctuary one more time. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope and my will be lost in thine. God, send down your preacher, for I cannot preach it by myself. Let the children of God shout amen, amen, and amen. From verses 6 and 7, then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. For a few moments this morning, my brothers and sisters, allow me to speak simply from this thought. I dare you. We good? It's okay. We still good? I dare you to show the evidence of the resurrection in your life. I dare you to show the evidence of the resurrection in your life. Help me out. Turn to a neighbor real quick. Say, neighbor. Come on, it's a bunch of y'all here this morning. Say it like you mean it. Say, neighbor. Oh, neighbor. I dare you to show the evidence of the resurrection in your life. Come on, just find one more neighbor. Say, other neighbor. Oh, other neighbor. Don't miss the evidence of the resurrection. Now, brothers and sisters, when we come to the 20th chapter of John, we find Mary Magdalene probably still wrecked with grief and full of emotion because of the events of the previous Friday, coming to the tomb of Jesus while it's still dark. And when she got there, the stone closing the tomb has been rolled away. Assuming the worst about the situation, the Bible tells us she runs to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb. We do not know where they've laid him." Mary has reported to the disciples that the body has been stolen. And this caps one of the craziest weeks ever recorded in the life of a human being. Looking back throughout human history, who ever had a week like Jesus had? From the cheers of Hosanna on Palm Sunday to the jeers of crucify him on Good Friday, Jesus has had a roller coaster of a week. Jesus was an innocent man sentenced to die on a horrible cross. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. Jesus is dying on that Friday, but even in his dying on the cross, he still found the strength to do ministry. He spoke his seven last sayings, starting with, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And after he said the seventh word, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," Jesus breathed his last breath. The author of life is now dead. The bread of life has now expired. The living water appears to have run dry. Jesus is dead. His body has been prepared for burial, and the disciples are in a state of confusion. The reality of that Friday was that this man whom they loved and followed and learned from and revered has been murdered. The disciples of Christ are dealing with a weekend of pain, of grief, of confusion, and of turmoil. Their leader is no longer with them, and they are now in mourning. Friday afternoon, their morning. Friday evening, their morning. Saturday morning, their morning. Saturday evening, their morning. And now we find ourselves back at the beginning of this message, early Sunday morning, with Mary Magdalene reporting that the body of the Christ has been stolen. Chapter 20 reports that the stone has been removed. And after Mary saw it, she ran to the disciples and said, "Brothers, look, they've stolen Jesus' body. We have no idea where they've laid him." Mary's statement to the disciples indicates that she believed that the body was stolen by grave thieves, and Mary is also the first person to miss the evidence of the resurrection. The stone being removed should have been evidence that something miraculous had taken place, but she took it as evidence of tomb raiding. Don't you know, my brothers and sisters, that at times our emotion and grief can block our acceptance of God working a miracle in our lives? Mary's life with Jesus should have told her that God was going to make a way out of no way. We know Mary Magdalene. Jesus cast 7 demons out of her and made her whole. We know Mary Magdalene. She was a faithful disciple who followed Jesus everywhere he went. We know Mary Magdalene. When most of the men had fled, she remained at the foot of the cross. She watched Jesus perform miracle after miracle. She listened as he taught kingdom principles, and she watched him expire on that cross. And now her grief causes her to miss the evidence of the removed stone. She runs and tells the disciples, and when Peter and John hear the news, they make their way to the tomb. The Bible says that they were running, but one disciple was faster than the other, and John makes it to the tomb first. He sees the removed stone and kneels down to look into the tomb, but he does not go in. He just looks in, peers in, and he sees, the Bible says, the linen wrappings lying there. In chapter 19, we're told that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus the Pharisee, in preparing Jesus' body for the Jewish burial, per their custom, wrapped him in spices and linen cloths. His body was wrapped tight by the 2 men, but John looks in and sees the linen wrappings lying there. John, Elder Worthy, is looking at evidence. Peter finally catches up with John, and he doesn't stop at the door of the tomb like John, but he went directly into the tomb. Verses 6 and 7 declare he saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings but rolled up in a place by itself. Peter is looking at evidence. Bible tells us that after Peter walks in, John follows behind him, and he saw and he believed. Now, many scholars suggest that John saw the linen wrappings and the face cloth and believed that Jesus was alive. But let me suggest to you from my studies that Peter and John saw the linen cloths and face cloth, and they believed what Mary had said. They have stolen the Lord out of the tomb. And I strongly believe that because the next verse in verse 9 declares, "For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead." And because of that, the disciples returned to their homes. They returned home because their spirits were crushed. They returned home because they thought the body of their master had been stolen. They returned home because they did not know what to do next. They returned home because, watch this, they missed the evidence. They missed the confirmation. They missed the verification, or they missed the proof of the resurrection. I'm almost done, but there were 3 pieces of evidence that they missed. Point of evidence number 1. They missed the evidence of the removed stone. Number 2, they missed the evidence of the burial wardrobe. Number 3, they missed the evidence of the word that Jesus spoke. Mary saw the stone and thought that his body was stolen. But if she had taken 5 seconds to breathe, to gather herself in, to move from a place of misery to a reflection on miracles. Maybe she would have seen the removed stone as evidence of the resurrection. Because from the beginning of John's gospel, Jesus is a miracle worker. Chapter 2, Jesus went to a wedding reception and turned water into wine. He knew how to work a miracle. In chapter 4, Jesus healed a royal official's son by simply speaking, "Go, your son will live." He knew how to work a miracle. In chapter 5, Jesus healed a man who had been lame for 38 years by the pool of Bethesda by telling him, "Stand up, take up your mat, and walk." He knew how to work a miracle. In chapter 6, Jesus fed 5,000 with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. He knew how to work a miracle. The list goes on and on. But if Jesus could work miracles like that, maybe Jesus could make sure a stone got rolled away. So when the disciples of Jesus saw that stone rolled away from the tomb, maybe the first thought shouldn't have been that they stole the body. But maybe they could have got happy right there and declared, "That's just my Jesus working another miracle." First, they missed the evidence of the removed stone. Secondly, they missed the evidence of the burial wardrobe. Now, my brothers and sisters, the burial wardrobe is not just something we can gloss over in the text because John mentions it once in chapter 19 and twice in chapter 20. We know that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus wrapped Jesus with spices and linen cloths according to Jewish tradition. We know that John saw the linen cloths but did not go into the tomb. We know that Peter went into the tomb and saw the linen cloths and the face cloth rolled up separate from the body wrappings. If the disciples had taken 5 seconds to breathe, 5 seconds to compose themselves and move from a place of brokenness to a place of reflecting on the burial wardrobe, maybe they would have seen the evidence of the resurrection. This was not the first time in the text that they were confronted with a burial wardrobe. Rewind just a few chapters. There was a brother named Lazarus, who was the brother of Mary and Martha. He was a friend of Jesus, and one day the two sisters sent word to Jesus that Lazarus was ill. The message said, "The one whom you love is sick." He wasn't just a casual associate, but Lazarus was a close friend. And Jesus responded, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of Man may be glorified through it." And he stayed where he was 2 more days. Y'all know the story. Jesus then tells the disciples that Lazarus has gone to sleep. And the disciples were so simple and hard-headed that they responded to Jesus, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus responds to them, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there so that you may believe, but let us go to him." By the time Jesus had arrived, Lazarus has been in the tomb 4 days. The Jews believed that the soul hung around for 3 days, but after 3 days, the soul would not be able to re-enter the body and would go to its final resting place. And because Jesus was there on the 4th day, there would be no possible way for a miracle to take place. But Jesus is a miracle worker. And he told them to remove the stone from the tomb. And after praying to his father, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and his feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." If the disciples had just taken the time to breathe and process what went down, they would have remembered that Lazarus came out of the grave wrapped in cloths and with his face covered. But now Jesus left the wrappings of death in the tomb, and he took the time to roll up the cloth that covered his face. Lazarus came out of the tomb bound, but Jesus walked out of the tomb free. Lazarus walked out of the tomb with his face covered, but Jesus took the time to fold that bad boy up. Lazarus had to be loosed by the people, but Jesus was loosed by the power of God. They missed the evidence. They missed the evidence of the burial wardrobe. Finally, they missed the evidence of the word Jesus spoke. Mary reported that his body has been stolen. Somebody stole Jesus. The disciples run to the tomb because they believe his body was stolen. They see the evidence of the stone, the evidence of the linen cloths, but they still did not grasp the reality of the situation. They returned home probably disillusioned, fearful of what was going to happen to them because their leader was dead. But if they had taken just 5 seconds to breathe and reflect on the words spoken to them by the divine word, maybe they would have believed in the evidence of the resurrection. In John 10, Jesus declared, y'all know, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. That's a word you can count on. In John 11, Jesus declares to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. That's a word you can count on. John 14, Jesus tells the disciples, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself. So that where I am, there you may be also. That's a word you can count on. And all they had to do was believe the evidence of the resurrection. And I just stopped by, my brothers and sisters, to remind you that Resurrection Sunday is not just a once a year event, but the reality of the resurrection is with every Jesus follower, 24/7, 365. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, God will show some evidence in your life. Do I have any witnesses that can testify? I've got some evidence in my life. The anointing of the Holy Ghost, that's the evidence. The breaking of chains in your life, that's the evidence. The confession of your sin, that's the evidence. The deliverance from strong bondage, that's the evidence. The empowerment to do ministry, that's the evidence. The faith to move mountains, that's the evidence. The gifts of the Holy Spirit, that's the evidence. The healing of your sick body, that's the evidence. The joy when life said you should be down, that's the evidence. The love that God gave you when you couldn't stand yourself, that's the evidence. The mercy that spared you from the punishment that you deserve, that's the evidence. The peace that surpasses all
all understanding. That's the evidence, the blessed assurance of our salvation. That's the evidence. And I'm so glad. I'm so glad that early Sunday morning he got up with all power in his hands, and the empty tomb is the evidence that Jesus lives, and our lives will never be the same. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds my future. And life, and life, and life is worth the living. Just because he lives, can you testify? I've got some evidence. I looked at my hands. My hands look new. I looked at my feet. They did too. I've got some evidence. I don't talk how I used to talk. I don't go where I used to go. I don't smoke what I used to smoke. I don't drink what I used to drink. That's the evidence. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus. Since Jesus. Since Jesus. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Oh.
That's the evidence. That's the evidence that you can open up your mouth after all you've been through and shout hallelujah! Come on, just turn to your neighbor. Say, neighbor, your life is the evidence. Your life is the evidence. If it had not been for the Lord on my side.
Yeah. Say, Lord, hallelujah.
The fact that you can shout, the fact that you can dance, the fact that you can clap is the evidence. Come on, let's shout our way out.
I
Let's stand to our feet as we open up the doors of the church. It's good to see y'all. I wish every Sunday was Resurrection Sunday. Oh wait, every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. Yeah. Oh, it's a good spirit in this house. We're gonna open up the doors of the church. We can shout until tomorrow. Every head bow, every eye closed in the sanctuary. For those watching in the virtual space on YouTube, agree with us as well. There was evidence at the tomb. This is a sanctuary full of evidence of the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. A church full of ex-addicts, ex-liars, ex-cheaters, ex-manipulators, ex-thieves, but the evidence that God can make a way out of no way is sitting right next to you. If you didn't know it, the person to your left or to your right is a sure enough miracle. Even if you don't know their story, looking at them clothed and in their right mind should let you know that God works miracles in the evidence standing right next to you. It's true, we serve a living Savior who loved so much that he gave his life for you and I. Gospel is simple. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever would believe in him, in Jesus, would not perish, but would have everlasting life. If you've never taken a trip down Romans Road, it's easy. Confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you will be saved. Hear me good. Coming to Bethel won't save you. Giving your tithes and offerings won't save you. Doing good deeds won't save you or I. The only thing that saves us is confessing with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and believing in our hearts, don't miss it, that the tomb is empty because God raised him from the dead. I'm going to ask two questions. We're going to move because I want to hear him sing this song. First question, if you are saved, if you are a believer, not a church member, but a disciple of Jesus Christ, just raise your right hand. Every head bow, every eye closed in the sanctuary. Every head bow, every eye closed. If you're sure enough saved, raise your right hand. Amen, hands down. Every head bow, every eye closed, because we're not trying to embarrass folks, not trying to put you on Front Street. Just trying to check on the status of your soul. If you are not saved, and that's okay because you're in the right place. If you've never made a public profession or confession of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you cannot remember giving your life to Christ, every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're not saved, not a believer, just raise your right hand. We're not here to put you on blast, not here to embarrass you, but if you're not saved, if you're not a believer, raise your right hand. I see some hands. Last question. You're close to eternal life. If you want to be born again today, it's no day like Resurrection Sunday. No time like the present. And I know we're socially distancing and we can do that. But this church, right? That's an altar, right? If you're not saved and you feel the Lord moving in your heart, I want to invite you to the altar that I might pray the prayer of faith with you in a socially distanced manner and invite you into the kingdom of God. For those hands that went up that don't know Jesus, every head is bowed, every eye is closed. Don't worry about who's looking at you. If you're not saved and you're in this place, don't worry about it. They don't have a heaven to put you in. They don't have a hell to keep you out of. Don't let other folks stop you from your salvation. If you aren't saved today, we'll give you a few moments because it's a big decision. But Jesus loves you enough to die for you. So as the musicians sing, if you're not saved and you want today to be your day, meet me at this altar. As Reverend Justin sings, for God so loved the world. If you want to be born again, if there's one, for those who are saved, begin praying even now in the spirit that God would turn a heart of stone into a heart of flesh. If you're saved, you should be praying that the Lord would save somebody else, just like he saved you. If there's one, if there's one in the virtual space, just type it in the comment section. Somebody from the church will be in touch with you. If there's one who needs salvation,
that so
if there's one,
on him,
let this be your day of salvation.
Should not perish.
Come on, one big choir. Let's help Reverend Justin sing.
Should
that's a good song.
Not perish.
What?
They shall have.
I'm gonna sing that again. That's good.
Everlasting life.
Come on, sing that again.
Everlasting life.
If there's one, if you're already saved, you don't have a church home, you're a spiritual free agent, you've just been in the wilderness, you love Jesus but you're not hooked up with a place that could hold you accountable, Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church in the wonderful city of Wilmington, Delaware would love to be your church home. I'd love to be your pastor. We're not a perfect church, I'm not a perfect pastor, but we do so with a perfect God, and we're filled with the perfect Holy Spirit who's sanctifying us or making us more like Jesus the Christ every day. If you're not a member of Bethel, but the Holy Spirit is pushing you this way, we invite you down to the altar of love. We're socially distanced and we'll accept you. But if you need a church home, just come on down as Reverend Justin continues to sing. We'd love to have you as a member of our fellowship. If you have a church home, just raise your hand in the sanctuary. If you're connected with somewhere, just raise your hand. If you have a church, just raise your hand. If you have a church, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Sting
we all members of Bethel? Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. The Bible is clear. Everybody's going to make it to brunch. Amen. Amen. Bible is clear. Shout out. Hey, First Lady, how you doing? So good to see you in the house.
Hallelujah.
And our daughter Shia. Amen. I guess she's going to crawl under the pews like Corey did, or that's what Bishop Beeman said. Amen. Amen. It's so good to see each and every one of you. All jokes aside, I know it's been a few years since some of y'all been back at the church. Amen. Let me just say this. Make this announcement. Church is open. Somebody say every week. Church is open every week. And every week we're going to take an offering too. Amen?
Amen.
Bible is clear. bring all the tithes into the storehouse. Hold on. Let him hear me real quick before we get too happy. I just want to hear me. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. Prove me not. See if I won't open up a window of heaven, pour you out a blessing, that there won't be room enough for you to receive. I say it every week. Tithing is simple, but tithing is an act of faith. For every dollar that God allows us to earn, God requires that we give at least, somebody say, a dime. A dime back to God for the working of ministry and the upkeeping of the temple. If you are a tither, we thank you for your faithful obedience to the word of God. If you're not yet a tither, we pray that 2022 be the year that you trust God with the 10% and watch God bless your socks off with the 90%. We want every member of Bethel to live under God's open window. And that starts when you follow the tithing principle and become obedient to the word of God. Whatever level you give at, we thank you for your faithful stewardship. And remember to put a smile on your face and in your heart, because God loves what kind of giver? Now, y'all got to say it like you mean it. What kind of giver? A cheerful giver. Come on, I just wanted them to hear me. Let's play that upbeat song again. You got it. Whatever you were going to play, come on and play it. We don't have our, so online, do we have our giving instructions for YouTube? Okay, our giving instructions are online. If you're giving through Givelify, you can give that way. If you're not giving through Givelify, you'll give your offering as you leave out of this place. But let's take about a minute to collect all of our offerings, and then we'll pray.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Everybody sing.
Lord, I
love.
Please see the ushers on your way out. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift. We thank you for the givers. Even on this Resurrection Sunday, God, we pray that you would give it back to them 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 times over, that they might continue to sow into good seed. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. And we offer this prayer in Jesus' name, and let the children of God shout amen. Let's stand to our feet all across the sanctuary. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Amen. For those who haven't had an opportunity to meet our First Lady yet, she will be here. Shia is going to be going back into the office, and she can start making her way now. But for those who haven't had a chance to meet our First Lady because of COVID and things like that, wave your hand. Babe, wave your hand. Amen. So please come say hello before you go. And it's so good to see each and every one of you on this another Lord's Day. Amen. Amen. Praise God from what? Hold on 1 second. Reverend Perry. Reverend Perry will take you back there because we do have COVID protocols. Amen. Where's the task force? The First Lady will meet you in the back. The task force is everywhere. Amen. There goes Sister Mo. So we'll greet you in the back. I see Brother Brown. Amen. The task force is everywhere. So First Lady will greet you all in the back. And as soon as she gets up the aisle, you know, get on down the road. Praise God from whom all of our blessings flow. Y'all enjoy brunch and the rest of this day. the linen wrappings lying there on the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Don't miss the evidence of the resurrection. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God be glory, majesty, dominion, and power now and forevermore. And with uplifted voices, let the children of God say, Amen. Amen.
Awesome worship experience we just had at Bethel. Now, before you leave, we just have a few updates and reminders just for you. Stay tuned for your Bethel happenings.
Rise, shine, and give God the glory. Join us every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 7 a.m. for Bethel's International Prayer Live. Use the dial-in details on your screen or visit our website for more information. Start your day in prayer.
Are you in need of a midweek worship experience? Tune in to The Hour of Power with iMac every Wednesday at noon on Facebook and YouTube. Get your praise break on your lunch break.
Hey, Bethel family. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to all of our social media sites. Let's stay connected.
And now it's time for our Bethel CYF update.
Hey, Bethel family. Join us this Friday for a family game night at 7 p.m. From all ages, 5 and up are welcome to come. Don't forget to wear your mask. We have all types of games, to board games, card games, and hard games, and even silly games too. I heard Pastor was an Uno champion. Let's see if he can keep up the title. Hope to see you guys there.
Have a blessed week, Bethel. We hope to see you and your entire family next Sunday, worshiping with us in the sanctuary.